Good morning and welcome to First United Methodist Church of Costa Mesa's online worship service. I'm Pastor Sarah and I would like to welcome you to this worship service and to my living room. I'm feeling a little under the weather, so we're doing a really good job of making sure that we stay socially distanced. So today I'm going to be delivering the message from my living room. I have a couple of announcements before we begin in worship together. The first is that November 29th, we would love your help. So that's next Sunday at 1 p.m. We need help getting ready to light the bell tower. That's a tradition that we do every year. Our bell tower is known throughout the city of Costa Mesa, and so we always try to make it a festive thing by having our bell tower decorated with lights, and we need your help. So at 1 p.m., if you're well, if I'm well, but if you're well, and anyone who can volunteer, please come wear a mask. We will be socially distanced, and we will be getting the tower ready to celebrate the beginning of Advent, which, by the way, is November 29th. And so we've got a couple of things and ways that you can be involved. If you want to participate in Advent, which is simply the season leading up to Christmas at First United, I want to invite you to order an Advent wreath Advent kit. So our Advent kit will have just different parts of an Advent wreath for to be able to put together an Advent wreath to be able to follow along with the various Advent wreath lightings. You can pick it up November 28th between 2 and 4, or you can arrange for the office to come and pick it up at another time, or you are welcome to, if you're local to the area of Costa Mesa, we would gladly drop it off for you. So the suggested donation for these Advent kits is $10. If that's not something that you're able to handle, please let us know, or if you can donate more than that. We wanna make sure that every family and every person is able to get an Advent kit. Along those lines, we're gonna be doing Honest Advent, which is a book by Scott Erickson, is a community during the season of Advent. You're gonna get a link to an online Advent calendar, which will start December 1st. But every Wednesday during Advent, you are also welcome to log on at 6 p.m. Every Wednesday, we are going to be going through sort of just talking about what your experience was with the art, as well as the Advent calendar. It's a way to gather together. And all of this information, just in case I miss anything, all of this information is going to be available down below and also in our weekly emails. Now, children, and those who have children, and those who know children, we are starting this new challenge where we're asking kids to send in photos. It can be a photo of anything, from a favorite toy, favorite rock, whatever they want. Either they can take the picture or they can ask you to take a picture. Then if you'll send it, email it in to us, simply say their name and their age. We're gonna weekly be doing a children's moment, a children's sermon just for kiddos during the online worship service as a way to engage our kids. And so that's gonna start on the 29th and I'm really excited about it, but send in photos and we'll make sure that your child, it can be a grandchild, it can be any kid that you know, that they're being engaged by the service. All right. I want to thank everyone who has been able to continue to give during this difficult season. And of course, we are continuing to monitor and figure out whether we're going to have our in-person gatherings both the first week of December as well as Christmas Eve, just as we monitor the situation. But I am so grateful that people continue to give financially to the church and to just the body of First United. So thank you so much for that. There's lots of ways to give. You'll see there is a link available. Also, social media. If you are wondering what's going on in the community or you just want to stay engaged, a great way to do that is follow us on all the social medias, YouTubes, and all that sort of thing at First United CM. All right, I think those are all the announcements, and I think my cough medicine might mean that I missed a couple. So if I've missed a couple, guys, please read your emails and please go through the announcements that are attached below. Thanks so much.
Hi y'all, we're the Taylors. Please follow along for our call to worship. This morning, we come into the presence of God,
who may not always be fully grasped,
but who may be gazed upon,
who is not easily understood,
but is full of understanding,
who does not seem to come at our beck and call,
but who is always near.
We gather together here in this digital space, believing that God is already here and deeply cares for all of God's children. Amen.
was blind, now I'm seeing in color. I was dead, now I'm living forever. I had failed, but you were my redeemer. I've been blessed beyond all measure. I was lost, now I'm found by the Father. I've been changed from a ruin to treasure. I've been given a hope and a future. I've been blessed beyond all measure.
The scripture for today is 1 Thessalonians 5, 12 to 28. But we appeal to you, brothers and sisters, to respect those who labor among you and have charge of you in the Lord and admonish you. Esteem them very highly in love because of their work. Be at peace among yourselves. And we urge you, beloved, to admonish the idlers, encourage the faint-hearted, help the weak, be patient with all of them. See that none of you repays evil for evil, but always seek to do good to one another and to all. Rejoice always, pray without ceasing. Give thanks in all circumstances, for this is the will of God in Christ Jesus for you. Do not quench the Spirit. Do not despise the words of prophets, but test everything. Hold fast to what is good. Abstain from every form of evil. May the God of peace himself sanctify you entirely, and may your spirit and soul and body be kept sound and blameless at the coming of our Lord Jesus Christ. The one who calls you is faithful, and he will do this. Beloved, pray for us. Greet all the brothers and sisters with a holy kiss. I solemnly command you by the Lord that this letter be read to all of them. The grace of our Lord Jesus Christ be with you. The word of God for the people of God.
Well, good morning again. I am filming this again from my living room as I have a head cold and I want to make sure to stay away from other humans. But we are in a series on the three essential prayers. And the three essential prayers comes from the work of Anne Lamott and her wonderful book, Help Thanks Wow, where she talks about the fact that there really are only three prayers that we need. And so last week we talked a little bit about what help is, how help is a prayer that many of us use to reach out to the divine and to sort of recognize that God is God and we are not, and it's an action of letting go. Well, this week we're going to talk about thanks and wow is the other two essential prayers. So let's pray first and then we're going to hop into this together. God, as always, I simply ask that the words of my mouth and the meditations of all of our hearts gathered here in this space online will be acceptable to you, because God, you are indeed our rock and our redeemer. Amen. Well, friends, in this series, we've been talking about how prayer can be this big kind of topic. People don't really want to pray in public. There's all this idea about what is prayer, what isn't prayer, how does prayer work? But when we were looking at it from sort of a simplistic way of trying to understand, like, hey, what are the elements that are needed in prayer? I found this work of Anne Lamott really helpful to think through it in sort of a more simplistic way. I think it's a great place to start. And there are lots of examples of prayer in scripture. One of my favorite ones that kind of stands out, or one that I don't even know if I should call it my favorite, but one of the ones that stood out for me always, was Matthew 6-7. When you pray, do not heap up empty phrases as the Gentiles do, for they think they will be heard because of their many words. As a kid, I used to hear this, and I remember the first time I saw a Saturday Night Live skit by Sally Fields is in it, and she is this wonderfully devoted person who feels like she has to pray all the time. And she has to use all of these words and make sure to cover everything, everything from her favorite soap opera to her husband going to work to her kid. And Jesus shows up and says, hey, lady, like, knock it off. I don't need all your words. Plus, you're, like, taking up the time. So it's a really funny skit. But it stuck in my head because I think sometimes I get so caught up in making sure that I say all the things I need to say, pray for all the things that I need to pray. So it was a good idea for me to think about Jesus showing up and being like, hey, lady, knock it off. I don't need you to keep praying all the time. But if we look like this, it may not be a skit of theological depth, but Jesus really is saying, you know, you don't have to use all these fancy words. It's more about kind of understanding a lens. It's not praying without ceasing in that, like, you need to just never stop talking, you know, very formally to Jesus, but it's more about a way of looking at our life. Paul wants the people of Thessalonica to really have this mindset and lens of thanks and wow. So let's talk about the church at Thessalonica. It's the capital of the Roman province. And this letter is, like, super friendly. Paul actually seems to really be pleased with how they're living out the Christian faith. They're the followers of the way. Most of them are likely from a lower strata, so they don't have leadership in the same way that some of the other churches have, because they are kind of led by upper crust that sort of have different ways of running things. So they're more of your common person. But the other thing that's super interesting about this, I think, is this idea that They're a church that's disappointed. What do I mean by that? Well, they're a church that's been waiting for Jesus to come back. And, you know, Paul has been saying it any time now, and Jesus hasn't shown back up. So they have been waiting for the Messiah to come back. In fact, Paul says it's going to be in our lifetime and all this sort of thing. So there are these people that are engaged in waiting. And actually, they believe that this letter is one of the oldest letters, if not the oldest letter. But it kind of has to backtrack on some things, because some of the things that Paul asserted has not come true. So they're being great role models, but even these people are struggling with the question of, where is Jesus? How has the Lord not come back? And remember from Mark 13:30, this generation will not pass away until these things have taken place. So they are wondering, like, what will happen to our loved ones? What's happened to our loved ones who have died? The end time has not arrived. Jesus has not returned. Yet this generation is passing away. So here they are wondering, are we going to be waiting forever? Now, I don't know how you feel as we are about to enter Advent of 2020, but it feels like Advent of 2020, the season of waiting, has actually been an entire year of waiting. We know what a waiting period feels like. The message to the Thessalonians is radical. It's really radical in nature because Paul is giving this idea that you're not to repay evil with evil, that you're to repay it with good. It's the opposite of the cultural context where payback and justice was maintaining and guarding respect. So you needed to have respect was the most important thing. And Paul is talking to these people and giving them just praise for the way that they really are helping people maintain this respect for each other and not feeling like they have to fight for their own. Paul invites people, again, this message is so radical. The season of waiting looks different than any other cultural thing they've ever gone through before, because Paul is inviting them to test out even the things that they hear. Verse 20 and 21, do not despise the words of the prophets, but test everything and hold fast to what is good. Hold fast to what is good. This is a big message here. So if Paul's kind of giving them a way to live in this season of waiting, the question now is how? How do I hold fast to what is good when things feel chaotic and when I am waiting? And I think this is where thanks and wow come in. Thanks and wow ground us in the here and now. Thanks and wow. Praying without ceasing really is about having a lens of thanks. So let's start with thanks. Next week is Thanksgiving, a season when we typically talk about what we're grateful for. But gratitude isn't always easy to hold on to. I'm going to read you a quote from Anne Lamott's Help, Thanks, Wow. I admit, sometimes this position of gratitude can be a bit of a stretch. So many bad things happen in each of our lives. Who knew? When my son Sam was 7 and discovered that he and I would probably not die at the exact same moment, he began to weep and said, if I had known that, I wouldn't have agreed to be born. This one truth, that the few people you adore will die, is plenty difficult to absorb. But on top of it, someone's brakes fail, or someone pulls the trigger, or snatches the kid, or someone deeply trusted succumbs to temptation, and everything falls apart. We are hurt beyond any reasonable chance of healing. We are haunted by our failings and mortality. And yet the world keeps on spinning, and in our grief, rage, and fear, a few people keep on loving us and showing up. It's all motion and stasis, change and stagnation. Awful stuff happens and beautiful stuff happens. And it's all part of the big picture. In the face of everything, we slowly come through. We manage to make new constructs and baskets to hold what remains and what has newly appeared. We come to know or reconnect with something rich and okay with ourselves. And at some point, we cast our eyes to the beautiful sky above all the crap we're wallowing in, and we whisper, thank you. Thank you. Thank you is a lens through which to look at the world. Gratitude is a hard place to reside in, and I wanna say that it takes practice. I've shared with you guys before that I have a gratitude practice where every day I write down 3 things that I'm thankful for, and that has been particularly life-giving for me in this season where things have been really hard. It has been a difficult time to be a pastor. It's just been a difficult time to be a human. And so writing those 3 things down has been helpful. What I notice is when I am faithful to that practice, I find more and more things to be thankful for. Meister Eckhart said, if the only prayer you said was thank you, that would be enough. If that was the only prayer. So what about wow? What is wow and how does wow ground us? Well, wow, I'm going to say, really isn't anything other than wonder. And wonder is when we come across something that we can't put into a category. And we're going to talk about wonder all through the season of Advent through our Honest Advent conversation. But wow, really, there is a rootedness in thanks, an ability to enter into wonder and wow. Wow isn't judgmental. It's a recognition that you don't know the outcome. So wow can be when you see something that is as horrible can be. Wow, I don't know how I'll get through this. And wow is also when you see something as beautiful as a sunset. I'm going to read to you another quote from this fantastic book by Anne Lamott. This comes from her section on wow. Wow has a reverberation. Wow, 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 wow. And this pulse can soften us, like the electrical massage an acupuncturist directs to our spine or a cramped muscle, which feels like a staple gun, but good. The movement of grace from hard to soft, distracted to awake, mean to gentle again is mysterious but essential as a tiny little control freak. I want to understand the power of wow so I can organize it and control it and up its rate and frequency, but I can't. I can only feel it and acknowledge it that is here once again. Wow. I'm going to continue reading in this quote about wow. Gorgeous things come into our life when we are paying attention. Mangoes, grandnieces, Bach, ponds. This happens more often when we have little expectation as possible. If you say, well, that's pretty much what I thought I'd see, you are in trouble. At that point, you have to ask yourself, why are you even here? If I were you, I would pray help. And help is from her previous chapter. Astonishing material and revelation appear in our lives all the time. Let it be. Unto us so much is given. We just have to be open for business. When we are available to see the wow in our life, to notice the moments and then be grateful for them, or be grateful for moments and then more wow shows up. I think that's what Paul means when he says that we are to pray without ceasing. I wonder if it means we are to be mindful and present to what is around us. Paul knew what it was like to wait. And we know what it's like to wait as we enter into the season of Advent that is like no other. The gift of praying thanks and wow is that it allows us to see God's goodness even in the waiting. And I hate waiting. We've been waiting for a lot of things. Waiting to see what will happen with a leadership change, waiting on a vaccine, waiting for such a long time, waiting to know about jobs, waiting to know when we can return to the new normal. So what are we to do while we wait? Pray without ceasing and rejoice. Praying without ceasing and rejoicing seems really hard. And it's almost been used as a weapon in the past. Praying without ceasing, this idea that you could never do enough. And it's funny because I think the people who use praying without ceasing and always rejoicing, even in the bad things, I have seen it used in such toxic ways when people go through things and I'll hear a pastor say, you know, all things work for good for those who love the Lord. Well, that's not really helpful when you're in the midst of a devastation. I don't think that's exactly what this is. In fact, I don't think this is a return to a law of something that you must do, but rather an invitation into something that you can be a part of. What is the rule? Paul, I want to know how I am meant to live, but Paul isn't demanding that people rejoice or that they pray without ceasing. Instead, Paul is naming something already present as a fruit of the Spirit, something that happens in partnership with the Spirit of God, something that happens in the waiting. William Loder says, nor is 16 speaking about endless prayer, lives filled with liturgical mutterings or thoughts and conversations punctuated with dearest Lord Jesus. It is more to do with connectedness. Friends, in this season of waiting, in this season of I don't know what to do, I think our invitation is to be invited into these three essential prayers. To first be willing to open ourselves to say help. And then next, and that takes vulnerability and honesty. And then next, to be willing to be grateful for things and to notice things around you, even when life really does feel like it's falling apart or unsure, and then to be open to the wow, the awe, the things that are so startling. I am grateful in this season to be able to travel and journey with all of you through all of this. I have to tell you, this book has been helpful for me, and I hope this series has been helpful for you to just sort of get back to some of the simplistic, the small, the help, the thanks, and the wow. I want to invite you to pray with me now. Help. Help me, God, when I am not sure that I can be vulnerable. Help me to know what it is that I need help with. Help all of us to be willing to risk relationship and friendship, not just with each other, but with you. Help us in our day to day. And now in your own hearts, lift up the things that you need help with. And now thanks. Thank you, God, for the unexpected places you show up and the love of, for me, my pet, for the joy of friends who call, for those moments that have felt like a blessing this week. And now I'll invite you to stop and think, even if it's just a one thing that you're grateful for today. And now, wow. Wow, God, I'm in absolute awe of your sunsets. I'm in awe also of the way that there's so much pain in the world. Sometimes, God, I need to pause and be reminded that I don't know where all of this is headed, but that I do know who you are. And so, God, when I stand in wonder and wow, I ask to feel your presence. And now, friends, will you pause and think of the things that made you feel a sense of wonder and awe this week? And God, for all of these things, and for how simple it can be, and for how complicated we often make a relationship with you, God, we ask that you would simply slow us down and help us say help, thanks, and wow.
Well, good morning, everyone, and happy Sunday. Will you join me now in singing Come Thou Fount of Every Blessing? Thank you. paid a debtor. Daily I'm constrained to thee. Let thy grace now, like a fetter, bind my wandering heart to thee. Come to honor, Lord, I feel it. Come to leave the God I love. Here's my heart, oh, take it, seal it. Seal it for thy courts above. I'm thou fount of every blessing. Tune my heart to sing thy grace.
Friends, I want to invite you to receive today's benediction, which is simply a blessing to go out throughout the week. And I want to invite you to open your hands as we do this. And the reason that we do that is to remind our bodies of the position, not just of our hands, but of our hearts, to be open to what is next. So let us receive this, the benediction. May we go out with the simplicity of realizing that all we need to say is help, thanks, and wow. May we be present to the world around us, to the divine within us and all things. May we be blessed so that we can be a blessing. Have a wonderful week, friends. Amen.